The polls have decided, and with a resounding voice, you people just had to beat the dead horse enough to where it's now spiraling across multiple timelines and slipped into the multiverse. We've covered the idea of zombies countless times, but hey, it gets the most views on this channel, probably because most people view me as a Left 4 Dead and zombie channel. So this week, we had to dive back into the genre one more time for the Why You Wouldn't Survive series. And oh lord, did I want to keep pushing this off because of the whole separate dimensions and timelines writing style. But alas, here we are. This week, we cover the zombie you may or may not see coming, endless horde mode, Rick and Morty level dimensional hopping, ancient beings that wish to corrupt humanity cliche, zombies that get tougher the longer the time passes, guns that can pack a punch, Stranger Things looking time wizards, the OG Civil War before America or the Avengers, Smithers release the hounds, let's use rickety old wood to barricade against the dead, an awesome tribute to the Godfather of the Dead, jumpers and shockers and werewolves. Oh my, the game mode is pretty representative of how you would actually be trying to survive, minus getting guns from chalk outlines and mystery boxes, but ultimately ending up dead to countless zombies game itself. This week, we are telling you why you wouldn't survive Call of Duty's zombie apocalypse. Just a quick footnote, this will be the Nazi Zombies universe set within Treyarch's ever-growing zombie lore, and we will not be covering Exo-Zombies or Infinite Warfare's take on the zombie outbreak either. Also, due to the severity of branching timelines and universes, we won't be totally covering the lore of the zombies universes, but focusing on subjects that factor into your survivability. If you want a complete lore video, I'm sure there's something out there that covers it a hell of a lot better than I do. Eons ago, there had only existed the Aether, also known as Paradise and or Agartha, a mysterious dimension that predates all existence, in which was inhabited by beings known as the Keepers. The ancient Keepers created a device known as the Summoning Key that pretty much had godlike Thanos-snapping power, allowing to create entire dimensions at will by harnessing the power of the Aether itself. Upon using the Summoning Key, a group of Keepers stumbled upon an evil presence within a new dimension called the Dark Aether. This evil presence corrupted the unlucky venturers and spurred a quick and brutal civil war forefronted by someone named the Shadow Man. The Pure of Heart Keepers were victorious and banished the corrupt to the Dark Aether, where overexposure to the evil presence transformed them into new creatures now called Apothicons. Realizing their inability to win against their Light of Heart brethren, the Apothicons dispensed Divinium Meteors to multiple different dimensions, specifically targeting humans in order to create chaos and further corruption. These meteors were full of a substance called Element 115, later to secretly be inserted into the periodic table known as Divinium, that had the power to reanimate dead cells and overcharge and soup up weaponry beyond human understanding. These meteors had crash-landed and fragmented into two human-inhabited dimensions, the first of which landed in the medieval times, where they were defeated by the Keepers and four mythical knights. The second crashed into Japan in the Rising Sun facility, and subsequently major parts of Germany, the Antarctic, and China. And last, the meteor that landed in the midst of the separate timeline in World War I dominated France, instantly creating the Nazi zombies we know in the first game. In the second time and third timelines, a team funded by 1939 Nazi Germany called Group 935 immediately sought to experimenting on the element tucked away in the space rock, seeking to create weapons, super soldiers, and means of teleportation. Seeing the world-dominating potential of this element, the organization led by Dr. Ludwig Maxis made sure that all members cut ties with family and government before fully committing in order to serve Germany to its full extent. One individual in Group 935, Dr. Edward Richtofen, a leading conspirator of the Illuminati, was invited and joined to relay information to the secretive organization. Richtofen primarily worked in 935 to master the technology of teleportation utilized by Divinium, where Richtofen and Maxis were first to discover that bodies that were used as a test to teleport would actually be resurrected as they were exposed to a concentrated electrical form of the new element. Element 115 could actually reanimate the dead into nearly unstoppable, relentless killing machines. There were numerous testing grounds and unscheduled breakouts that occurred in places like an abandoned airfield or the Verrückt Insane Asylum, but the teleporter itself was unsuccessful. Richtofen wanted his work into teleportation to bear further fruit, or nut in this case, when Richtofen attempted to transport a Walnut, and it worked. Yet Maxis said these attempts were nuts and stopped work on it. But Richtofen went behind his back and continued the research long enough to teleport himself. Ending up in the catacombs of the moon, Richtofen discovered the MPD, a mysterious pyramid device that could be utilized to harness the very aether, and thus the reanimated dead could be controlled. The Shadow Man was starting to pull the strings on Richtofen as a puppet. Richtofen was electrocuted by the MPD and started experiencing schizophrenia and images of the Apothicons, and more importantly, their leader, the Shadow Man. Slowly being corrupted, he was transported again to a distant jungle in Shangri-La, where he spent 3 weeks working on and learning about the real energy source, and more importantly, discovering the Focusing Stone. This power drove him to try and find the Aether Universe, renouncing the Illuminati and staying with 935 to see to using Element 115 to its fullest expanses in order to achieve his ultimate new goal, or I should say, the Shadow Man's goal. He soon saw to the creation of a moon base and trying to fuel the pyramid, which, after the death of a mouse nearby, saw to a slight charge, showing life energy fueled the device. Experimenting on live specimens like prisoners of war, seeing them driven mad to the point of break that completely wiped their memories, turning Dempsey, Nikolai, Takeo, and Samantha into his unknowing tools for success. He spurred the creation of the weapons we spam on zombie mode through mystery boxes like the Wunderwaffe, Ray Gun, and basic 115 enhancements for any standard issue military weaponry. However, the promise to mass produce the Wunderwaffe specifically was constantly put on hold by Maxis in order to aid in the war efforts Germany was so enthralled in. You think he would be making more of these superpowered guns to help Germany win the war. All this while Richtofen was forcefully subjecting Samantha Maxis, Dr. Ludwig Maxis's daughter, to experimentation efforts. After more teleportation experiments had been failing, a test had been done on a dog owned by Samantha. The dog Fluffy, now converted into a hellhound, becoming rabid and feral, Samantha chased after her pooch into the teleporter, with her father right behind her trying to stop her. Richtofen teleports the three of them to unknown areas to get rid of them. Samantha was transported to the MPD, where she was absorbed and corrupted by the dark aether. Maxis was taken to the crazy place, where he gained the ability to merge with electricity. In the insanity, Samantha's merging with the pyramid led to desperate measures from Richtofen, who teleported Maxis back in order to stop his daughter, who was now insane and in control of every single living zombie. But in actuality, Maxis instructed his corrupted daughter to kill them all, and merged with the moon base she resided in, leading to the zombie outbreak that became so widespread. Richtofen uses the Mind Wipe squad from earlier, who resorted to helping Richtofen as they had no prior memories to think of, to blow through the zombie horde in various different time periods, where Samantha's reign dominated for decades, even up until 2025, to retrieve the Vril device, Focusing Stone, and to basically survive in order to achieve his goal and overthrow Samantha. When the group finally accomplishes their goals and it's all set in place, Richtofen swaps bodies with Samantha in order to assume control. An old man in a little girl's body? What's that sound? Oh!
We got him.
With Richtofen's ultimate betrayal to his merry band of four people, Maxis contacted them, instructing them to aid him in defeating Richtofen, and in the only way why you wouldn't survive scenarios usually end out in, by launching hundreds of ballistic missiles at Earth to sever electronic communications and relays to Earth, and wipe out large portions of the zombie armies and innocent civilians, pretty much scorching the Earth itself. While this didn't quite dethrone Richtofen, it did, however, lessen his outreach, but still allowed for full control of all of Earth's infected. The metaphysical powers of both Richtofen and Maxis led to them recruiting any sentient life left on Earth to do their bidding in order to, once again, achieve their hidden goals. Richtofen, to mend the right in space and time to assume total control of the Aether as the Shadow Man wanted since the start of it all, or Maxis to reunite with his daughter in the Aether by completely destroying Earth? The big difference being that Richtofen could only communicate with the dead and those that consume the flesh of the dead, leading him to be a voice in the heads of pseudo-cannibalistic people in the group called the Flesh. Depending on the player's choices, depends on what happens with the ending of this ultimate story. So I'm going to stop here, but this is the universe we will be going off of, because it covers most lore-related bases. Now it may seem like I'm trimming the fat, but I really don't need to speak about variations in character deaths and stories from Universe 63, as they all share the same power, relatively speaking. And maybe I'm just trying not to make this entirely a lore video. area. Now, onto the Why You Wouldn't Survive portion. It's important to note we will be keeping things into one timeline and into the present. No time traveling. Now, what's important to note about these zombies, they don't infect people traditionally like the generic zombie does. They do not bite you, you get infected, and you change, as only exposure of element 115 to a dead body could resurrect them, which may be the case for Romero since he was dragged away off screen and exposed to 115 by zombies. I guess they saw value in a mind ripe with zombie knowledge. I'm just hoping they don't turn to me to turn me into a god zombie. Actually, becoming a god tier zombie. Any and all biological creatures could be converted into a zombie archetype if exposed to divinium, including dogs into hellhounds, monkeys into, well, space monkeys. This all probably stemming from either Japan or Germany. Let's just say the organization 935 lied dormant after the defeat of Nazi Germany for decades, working on the pure use of divinium into making zombies and other tech and weaponry. Let's just throw out there, maybe it broke out in one of these countries, or 935 strategically placed divinium-laced nerve gas in central parts of major American cities and other major integral cities across the world, and predetermined and established a leader for the undead as they grew. How would it factor into us not surviving? Well, there's the whole ordeal of the troops of this vastly growing army once people did die one by one. The normal run-of-the-mill zombies themselves aren't all that powerful, biting, smacking, and punching you in succession to maul you to death. Being able to not only survive with their limbs being dismembered, but will crawl towards survivors at any cost to kill them. They have the ability, much like Left 4 Dead Infected, to jump up and scale up high places, so getting the high ground will not always be advantageous. They will break through barricades with enough time as well, so making sure to be in a fortification that is more than just 2x4s and wilted wood would be much more preferable. They can also dig their way underground like a diglet and pop up anywhere that doesn't have reinforced flooring. Even then, powerful zombies could burrow their way through even that reinforced flooring with enough force. But like any other zombie apocalypse, they developed their strength in numbers at first. While the zombies were created in order to be controlled, that just wasn't possible at the time of their creation, and would and could be used as a slew of independent variables that could be dumped into an area to overwhelm forces, while the people that dumped the zombies would retreat away. Zombies can be created into a number of different variants, whether it be widened experimentation, species gaps, or dependent on what elements or equipment is attached to them at their bodies during infection from the divinium. Crawler zombies have devolved into a mostly angler fish-like state, point being that they are a head with mostly just a gaping tooth-filled mouth. They, however, have no use for eyes and really don't even have eyes to speak of, and most likely either rely on echolocation to sound out where a survivor is, or rely on reading the life force of survivors mentally or through a survivor's aura to hunt them down. Regardless, they earn their name by crawling around on all fours at about the same pace as a regular zombie, and will exude a green gas behind themselves that affects a player similar to the early stages of Novagas's effects, temporarily giving partial blindness, toxic air to restrict breathing, and disabling some motor functions, and even more heinous side effects. I also wouldn't recommend getting too close, as a bite from that thing would be a lot more intense than a run-of-the-mill zombie bite. These guys could find it easier to tear through you. Napalm zombies, whether they were created or changed by environmental factors, will constantly be on fire, and if approaching a survivor close enough, can ignite and explode themselves in a flurry of ember and bone shrapnel that can be fatal within direct close range, while also leaving a roaring fire in their place after detonation. While it would be useful to blow them up within hordes, they can take a hell of a lot of damage before rupturing. Plus, the ensuing flames, if done indoors or in a dry forest-like area, could lead to a very fast wildfire that could trap you or force you out of a fortified area. Hope you stocked a fire extinguisher. Next, coming burrowing from underneath at a high pitch, the Shrieker, much like the Siren from Killing Floor, can scream at such a high pitch rate that it can actually not only rupture your eardrums, but can actually blind you temporarily. The Shriekers can be faster than usual zombies and will attack in a similar manner once they have crippled their prey. Much like what I said with the Screecher or whatever, if they find you by yourself and there's no zombies around, they can easily scream and alert the them to your location, but they're mostly of a hive mind intelligence once they're being controlled, so there might not be a use for that. But either way, if you're deaf, it's going to be a little bit harder to fight the undead. While we didn't take the time to discuss the partner group to 935, the Japanese subsidiary Division 9, they did make even more brutal zombie types that would prove to be even more savage and kill-thirsty. Mutated with what is most likely plant-related spores, this hulking behemoth will develop tree trunk-like appendages and can only be brought down by destroying the sac-like growths on its body. They can launch spores at people to paralyze you and then slowly devour you whole. That's right, they can eat you up in one gulp like a snake. Their strength alone is enough to kill you with one swing, so trying to take it on would not be advisable in the slightest, unless you have some serious firepower, and unless you want to be a meal for a tree wanting revenge on vegetarians. Jumping jacks can also start popping up out of nowhere, using the ability of teleportation and short distances to quickly overwhelm and sneak up on unwary survivors, dependent on the natural production of electricity that can burst forth upon death. They too have powerful jaws to sink their teeth into your flesh, and with the ability to teleport, having any kind of defensible doorway or entrance would be nullified as a pop right through your defenses and ate you while you slept. Some 115 experiments go underneath the skin and can hide themselves underneath the flesh of a regular zombie, turning them into catalysts. Once they have been damaged or existed long enough, harnessing the elemental powers of either lightning, water, poison, or fire, they can rupture forth, all blowing up upon death. Wow, zombies really are mostly only good for kamikazeing upon death, aren't they? They're just all blowing up. It's kind of like developers just don't know what to do and they just kind of make the boomer types. 115 can also latch onto monkeys who, for better or worse, don't focus too heavily on killing you, but will primarily focus their attention onto disabling 115-related machinery and weapons, lessening your chances of fighting against the zombie horde. Now don't get me wrong, a feral monkey trying to rip you to shreds sounds terrifying enough, but for a zombie type to go after basically your only good defense and offense against the dead is equally as terrifying, because if they are successful, will pretty much leave you naked. If you do end up trying to attack them while they are monkeying around with your technology, they will throw their toxic 115 shit at you to daze you, or if you throw a live grenade at it, we'll chuck that bitch right back at you, showing zombie monkeys are somewhat smarter than regular zombies. This virus can also modify and enhance living humans or zombies to god-tier proportions, much like what occurred with George A. Romero when he was transformed into the director. While mostly a gimmick as a game boss, this Thor-like behemoth of a zombie, wielding electrified, hammer-like stage light, can take nuclear levels of gunfire, even from modified pack-a-punched weapons. He will most likely try to beat you into a bloody pulp with his stage light, and if shot or if he hits someone, will become enraged and become faster and even more violent. If any zombies are within a nearby radius of a swing of the stage light, will become electrified and shock survivors that are unlucky enough to approach them. While Mr. Romero has passed on, it doesn't go without saying that if someone of a creative mind like his were to be converted, we may be facing an impossible, undying challenge like him. Boss zombies, much like Romero, will also start cropping up across the globe, threatening your continued existence, much like Brutus, adorned with high combat / riot armor and a human conscience, or the Blightfather, who cannot be killed while transforming from a few regular zombies by normal artillery or human weaponry. Its invincible transformation leads to a walking quadruped that can spit vomit on you from long distances, lasso you with its tongue to pull you in and lacerate you with its jagged claws and mow you down. Panzer Soldats are heavily armed, almost Big Daddy-like fortified zombies that use flamethrowers to char their prey while also grappling prey from long distances to bring them in quickly or using their rocket packs to close the distance. Basically just Big Daddy zombies with more attachments. Now food and water may be hard to come by as these varieties of the dead come knocking at your door, diminishing whatever ammo or quality of weapons you have. You are not going to be able to keep a good stock of ammo against just billions of zombies over time. But you are in luck if the livestock, canned goods, and crops of the world are destroyed in the everlasting chaos even after the nukes and missiles fly. You can actually eat the flesh of zombies. Now, before you're saying that's cannibalism and really can't be safe to eat, let me just say that exposure to zombie blood and flesh will not relatively infect people. Much like any other meat, you could fry or cook up some zombie giblets after taking out a horde, and the only real side effect, besides tasting horrible, possibly diseased meat, will cause you to be communicated with telepathically by whoever ends up controlling the zombie hordes, because you do have a piece of zombie in you. And that that is also determined if there is anyone at the steering wheel. The zombies' eyes glow different colors depending on who is in control of them as well. The reanimated dead can be controlled if a shrunken version of a meteor called the Focusing Stone is taken and pretty much absorbed into a living, sentient being, commanding the entirety of the world's undead army. As seen by Richtofen, who betrays his squad after going through hell and high water to acquire it. And by Elizabeth. Do you think this is one of the Infinity Stones Thanos needed? A large number of people were able to slip their conscience into the stone and assume control of the masses. So it all depends on who is in control of the destructive forces. Now you may think, well, what if someone with a pure heart were to reign over? Well, considering the Apothicons are a corrupted race that have pretty much mastered the art of darkening a heart of light and corrupting people like Merrick did with Joey, it's safe to say we wouldn't be having any good Samaritan zombies mowing lawns and fixing bridges around the world. So if a person of strategic and evil contents were able to take over, we would see the systematic destruction of Earth by never-ending waves conglomerating on you if you choose not to do the person's bidding or if they just want total human extinction. This time around with the zombies, they aren't just roaming around endlessly or aimlessly. If someone does take control, they can all conglomerate on one location and take someone out. These are zombies with direction, purpose, and strategy. And if you're thinking you will be the one in charge of the stone, yeah, good luck getting to the moon if you somehow found a teleporter or rocket to get there and somehow weaseled your way past a little girl's damaged psyche and her army. Fighting your way there would require particular weaponry and a savant nature on 115 tech. The only manageable way to fend yourself off against the progressively thicker and stronger hordes of the undead would be able to find yourself weapons or machinery modified by element 115. Basically fighting the metaphorical fire with fire, weapons implemented with 115's design in mind would be manufactured like the Wonder Wolf and Ray Gun. But as stated earlier, Maxis had these restricted to mostly beta models that were never mass produced. Although, after many generations after the World War, we may be seeing these 115 laced weapons being distributed from arms dealers like Lockheed and Martin if they were to find this and get a steady supply of Divinium. But it would probably stay within army and military outposts, but you probably wouldn't be seeing any of these. Perks like Juggernog and Faster Speed would allow you to be more versatile and able to survive against the waves of the growing dead. If you're willing to pull a Bioshock and drink an unknown chemical that may or may not have these adverse side effects in the long term, and that's only if you are lucky enough to have these vending machines that dispense these miracle cures readily available where you are positioned. Everyone thinks that they could just drink a Juggernog, but you gotta think, are they gonna be around as much as Coca-Cola vending machines? I don't think so. I'm sure they would be developed in limited quantity before the zombie outbreaks, but they would only be dispersed relatively close to research centers, security compounds, and military outposts associated with Divinium projects. Military complexes would also see to weaponizing 115 to make Novagas, a nerve agent that can blind, debilitate, burn the flesh, and instantly kill an individual right as they breathe it before they even hit the floor from suffocation. The second you breathe in that gas, you are going to turn into a zombie. If Soviets or other major countries use these scientifically deadly devices to get their hands on the 115 version of Novagas and refine it, we would see a gas that would pretty much instantaneously convert people into zombies, a conversion rate completely unseen to this day, even comparable to 28 weeks later, World War Z and Phineas and Ferb, which did it within a few seconds. So if you did side with the controller of the zombies or not, you may be facing different factions of humans whose ideals run parallel to yours and fight you within these powerful weapons and tech. Vaporizing you into goo with a ray gun or incinerating you with a Wunderwaffe, fighting the zombies wouldn't be your only worry. So while you are shooting at a smorgasbord of the undead on your left, you'll be defending yourself from human factions on the right, all while the big man upstairs pulling the strings has been playing everyone for a puppet, as the Dark Aether would probably have already completed their plans through a human host and would subsequently either destroy the Earth and leave, or Maxis bombarding our worlds with nuclear hellfire, Richtofen planning to turn us all into zombies in order to control the world, or, again, Maxis sacrificing the planet to see his little girl again. Either way, it seems like we are ultimately screwed when it comes to the variety of zombies, the overpoweredness of the weapons that could be used against us, to humans that could turn against us, to ancient aliens' intentions that want to take control. A bit long and all over the place, that about wraps up this video. did you? Did I miss out on anything or not explain the end of the world as we know it if Call of Duty zombies popped into our existence? Not enough about the whole origins being Nazi zombies? Let's have a discussion and see what the other dimensions could have offered, because I'm damn sure I missed something amongst all this fictional chaos. Let me know in the comments, berate me, dislike it, it's your choice. But if you enjoy the 20 plus minutes of content, please feel free to answer the Call of Duty and like, sub, and ring that bell. You can also donate to the channel to support me with any kind of contribution by going to my Patreon, link in the description, or donating during my live streams to have your name featured here on the left. And hey, maybe even hit the join button to support me monthly. I have a new tier list for donators too, as you can see. I have merch repping Left 4 Dead on my own personal brand, so check out my Teespring and, oh crap, the sponsorship. This video was also brought to you by Inhiba.com, offering deals up to 70% off every weekend for PC, Xbox, and PS4. Join at this link, Inhiba.com/join/WoW, for $1.14 towards your first purchase, and use code WOW at checkout for an additional 3% off. Ooh, last minute, but hey, at least you didn't have to sit through it at the beginning. Keep an eye on the community tab for polls on what comes next on the Why You Wouldn't Survive series. And like always, thank you so much for coming by. I'm Zach S, aka WoW Such Gaming. Stay WOW!